On Breakfast with the Arts, NRBQ, the story of the sensational new rhythm and blues quartet. And as our special artist of the week, the band joins us here in the studio. Kelly Dedman talks to Nicolas Cage and the cast of the new Sir Ridley Scott film, Matchstick Men. Plus on Open Book, authors Linda Fairstein and James Frey. All coming up on Breakfast with the Arts. Welcome to Breakfast with the Arts. They've been called the greatest band in America. It's NRBQ, the versatile new rhythm and blues quartet. In accomplished performances of a variety of musical styles, NRBQ defies definition. Together for more than 30 years, the band enjoys a fanatic following, counting among its many admirers Elvis Costello, Bonnie Raitt, and the Rolling Stones' Keith Richards. Whether you're already a devoted fan or this is your first introduction to the group, you're sure to enjoy this up-close look at a musical phenomenon.
The following program is not about the horrors of fame, the tragedy of immense wealth, or the nightmare of nonstop sex with supermodels. It's about music.
The greatest rock and roll band of all time.
Certainly one of the best live bands I've ever seen.
I would describe them as the perfect amalgamation of sound.
They've got beautiful, sweet voice ballads.
They are a band's band.
And they rock like crazy.
The thing about a band is, can they hang? And you know that the guys can get along for that amount of time. They've got something going.
Who are they talking about?
NRBQ.
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 NRBQ. BQ. You try saying that. It's not a word. It's a band, right?
New Rhythm and Blues Quartet has been together over 30 years. Its fans include Paul McCartney, Bob Dylan, Lou Reed, Iggy Pop, Eric Clapton, and thousands of devoted Q heads around the world.
The people that love NRBQ are the echelon, the cream of people that get it, in my opinion.
If you don't like NRBQ, I don't like you.
A rock band not knowing how to handle fame and fortune is a story we're all familiar with. But how does a band that's been together for 35 years and that many consider the best kept secret in rock and roll handle never receiving the fame they deserve? Well, if the band is NRBQ, they just keep playing.
I saw NRBQ sometime in the 70s. It must have been 76. And I kind of went, God, I got to go buy those guys' records.
I've been in a band, the same band, since 1962. Now, to me, these guys are kind of spring chickens.
As with so many of the great musical things I know about, Peter first turned me on to the Q in the early 80s when we started hanging out and listening to music together. But I was blown away. Just the musicianship and the insanity of it, I thought it was wonderful.
But in terms of melodic, beautiful ways with melody, this band is a cut above anybody working that hasn't been around since the Beatles.
Trying to describe NRBQ to anybody is pretty difficult if they've never come across them. But you have to really just put on the records, and then that's when you know what they are.
I think the biggest misconception about NRBQ is that they are a cult act. You know, to me, a cult act is, you know, somebody who's doing something that's kind of inaccessible to the masses or hard to get, and they're anything but.
time I wore this shirt was on the first year of the show, and you know, nobody knew who the hell I was doing. They were like, oh, what does that stand for? Now that's got to stand for something. That's got to be wrong. It's something obscene. So just so you know, it's the New Rhythm and Blues Quartet.
Spells drugs in Lithuanian.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, when I see somebody with a Q hat or an NRBQ shirt, I immediately go over. It's like a pajama party. You know, because it's the secret society. You know, it's the Masons.
I remember the first time I saw NRBQ, and you know, it's actually a very funny story. Marge had been kidnapped by a motorcycle gang, and the kids insisted I go look for her. Seen a woman wearing? That's more like it. I'm looking for.
It's our favorite show. It's actually the best show on TV, and it has been for a long time. It just so happened that we got to meet Mike Scully, who was executive producer of the show, and happened to be a fan of ours, and started to use some of our music in the show.
An episode where a motorcycle gang was living in the Simpsons house, and we needed a song to go with the scene. So rather than choose a cliche like Born to Be Wild, I decided to try something different and used NRBQ's Me and the Boys.
They got some really great straight up pop songs that in more ruthless hands probably would have yielded, you know, that a shorter and you know, brighter career. But I don't know how the guys feel about it, but I wouldn't have traded it for what they've done.
I could put up a Joy is Poppin' Out a Ballad against any Beatles song, or in any rocker against a Chuck Berry song, any of the greatest classic records that are considered by the board of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, you know, to be the ones we bow from. These records will stand up sonically, melodically, lyrically.
And if you go to see the show, you know, you can hear a song and you go, well, that's just a hit. That's a hit song in anybody's book, you know?
Beautiful, sweet voice ballads, along with all of the more outlandish aspects of what they do.
I always think "Rain at the Drive-In" for much later in their career is kind of a perfect song. Oh,
NRBQ was formed over 30 years ago in Miami, Florida, by pianist Terry Adams and bassist Joey Spampinato.
I met Terry there in 66, and we had like a local band down there that we put together. And he was someone that I thought was a lot like me. It's the first time I met anyone that had musical taste the same.
In the beginning, I wanted to be in and around musicians that would play anything, anytime, because they loved it.
We had like a fire for the right, for the same things, and what we wanted us to be. And so he was the first person that I ever met that was like me. And we've been together ever since.
After landing a recording contract with Columbia Records in 1968, the New Rhythm and Blues Quartet released their first album. I'm so down, sales were disappointing, and as NRBQ prepared to record the second of their two-album deal, Columbia asked them to put it on hold and work on a record with rockabilly legend Carl Perkins.
Well, all of my friends is bopping the blues, and it must be going round.
What the band didn't know was that Columbia would call the Perkins album their second record, ending their deal with the label.
It was one of those rare moments of dishonesty in the music business. I'm sure that guy was fired.
The album did, however, offer a preview of what would become the trademark NRBQ sense of humor, with a song based on a line from a classic Three Stooges short.
Calling Dr. Howard, Dr. Fine, Dr. Howard.
And they'll write a song about anything, and that's like one of my favorite things about the element of NRBQ. On last album I heard, you know, they got the Maids Knocking on the Door song.
If you can write something funny about something you hate, you know, I guess it makes life easier, but I really think it's unfair the way we've been treated in motels and hotels with that housekeeping.
I think just the sheer spontaneity of what NRBQ has always done is what always excites me. I mean, almost anyone you go see, you've got a pretty good idea of what they're going to do.
Not these guys.
It's getting to the point where I'm no fun anymore. I am sorry.
And they add to that, but you know, when the quartet switches around the instruments, when they all like get up and then they'll, you know, somebody will take the bass, somebody else will take the guitar, it gives you this feel like it's just kind of wild and happening right in front of you.
I thought that was just showing off, actually.
I love when we switch instruments on stage. I love what comes out, you know, it's fun.
NRBQ is like 100% pure skill coupled with wackiness.
That sense of humor has always characterized a lot of the band stuff. Maybe it's even, you know, hurt them a little bit in achieving mainstream success because it makes them harder to kind of pigeonhole into one category, but I can't imagine them without it.
They ended their set with the record of Edmund Fitzgerald one night, and the audience was like, oh man, that's bad news. So they came back for the encore and did it again.
The legend lives on from the Chippewa on down of the big lake they call Gitchagumi.
Yeah, we had the sheet music to it.
We read every verse.
It was just like a long song.
And did it at the tempo that it suggested.
By like halfway through, people were going, boo, stop, stop.
Fourth chorus or something in there.
Then we started sitting down. But we said, but you made this a number one song. What's wrong? And it, eventually we were lying down.
Well, I might have fallen asleep during the third or fourth verse. There's so much going on with that song, you know. Like,
the ship was the pride of the American side.
And, you know, I was talking to Bonnie Raitt. She goes, oh, that's nothing. I headlined over them once, and they did that. They did it two times in a row, so Bonnie learned Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald and came out and played it for to open her set.
Nearly caused a riot.
She was just saying, well, you know, that's what you have to do when you play with those guys. You got to keep up.
Ah, bonjour. Petty. Petty. Mais oui, mon petit. Mais oui, mon petit. Ah, Petty. Promenade avec moi, Petty.
They're truly fearless. They'll do anything, and it's real. You know, the intention is pure.
Petty, Petty, mais oui, mon petit, mais oui, mon petit.
One of the things I love about NRBQ is they haven't forgotten that rock and roll is supposed to be fun.
Breakfast with the Arts will continue with NRBQ, rock and roll's best kept secret.
Control with Time Warner Discs.
NRBQ recorded the album Scraps and Workshop for an independent label with new guitarist Al Anderson.
I'm like a magnet. You're like a piece of wood.
But the diversity of musical styles that made the album so much fun to listen to puzzled their record label, who had no idea how to market NRBQ.
The thing that needs to be done in order to become very, very successful in popular music, particularly in America, is to do the same thing over and over and over again with very little variation. And that, of course, is the exact opposite of what they do in every performance.
When I was a teenager, I studied privately with a composition and theory teacher, and whenever I brought in something I wrote, he'd look at a few lines and he'd say, you're boring me now, you know? So I guess what I got out of that was, don't bore me.
Undeterred by their early lack of commercial success, NRBQ played on. As word of mouth spread about NRBQ's highly charged live shows, their devoted audience continued to multiply, especially in the Northeast, which had become home base for the band.
NRBQ is from where I'm from. I'm from Western Massachusetts, and they were always playing all around there. But the first time I saw them, embarrassingly enough, was San Francisco. I moved out there to do a stupid show with my partner, Teller, and NRBQ was playing, and I was like, oh, they're a local band. And I had heard great stuff about them and went to see them. And that first show I saw, and I think called The Stone, which is a Bill Graham place in San Francisco, is still, if not the best music show I've ever seen, certainly in the top five.
Certainly one of the best live bands I've ever seen. And they never look bored or tired of the songs or stuff you get when you see other bands for 10 times the money.
I do remember
remember about seeing them for the first time is what a madman Terry Adams is. You know, I mean, that's what I came away with was, my God, he does all this and he actually manages to play the notes too.
Piano's just a big, 88 drums.
I would say that NRBQ is the distillation of every single type of music that's ever existed in America, with a sense of humor.
In Terry Adams, you've got like somebody that manages to bring two or three, you know, he bring to mind two or three greats of American music, and they're not all in pop music, you know, like in just in the way he sits at the piano, you know.
I just think there isn't anybody as funky and as inspirational and as funny and as spontaneous. They will be rockers when they're 90. And they're my heroes. Can you talk?
I rock with my pocket. And I think that song kind of shows you how they can really hit that R&B groove.
NRBQ's live shows are legendary for their fun and unpredictability. And unlike other bands, NRBQ never predetermines which songs they'll play on a given night.
When they opened for us, that was probably the most I ever saw them in a row. I think I saw them 37 times. It was kind of neat to see that, you know, on the 36th or whatever it was show, they were doing songs that I hadn't seen them do yet. You know, without a set list, too, which is really impressive.
I think if we had to do the same thing every night, we'd flip. We wouldn't be able to stand it.
That's sort of what's fun about it, is that we don't know what's coming, too, just like the audience, you know.
I'm never really happy unless something happens I didn't think was going to happen, including in the studio. It makes me happy.
In 1974, America was in the middle of a severe gasoline shortage. NRBQ's record label took advantage of the situation by re-releasing their song, Get That Gasoline Blues, as a single. Ironically, the band had written the song in 1966, and it had nothing to do with the 70s energy crisis. Nonetheless, Get That Gasoline Blues made the Billboard Top 100 and remains NRBQ's only charting record to date. 1974 was also the year that a fan at an NRBQ show unknowingly auditioned to join the band.
One night, I was at a show, and came time for an encore, and I guess the old drummer, Tom Staley, wasn't feeling good, so he was out in the bus and never came back for the encore.
Artolino had written fan letters to NRBQ and met them backstage a few times.
And I told him I played drums, but I never was in a band before. I learned to play with records in my basement. And Terry just pointed over to Tom and said, get on. And I was scared, I'm going, nah. He came up and he just laid it down. Al, the guitarist, then turned around. He thought it was the old regular drummer. So when it came time to try out for drummers for our band, he was the first one that came to mind. We said, well,
I said, it might, you know, it might be crazy. We don't know if he can play all the different styles of music that we play. We know he likes it, and we know that he's smart. He says, but we got to give it a shot because it's you know, it's you have to.
I'm starting my 27th year last month.
When we come back, NRBQ invents the rock and wrestling connection and wins the respect of the world's greatest rock and roll band.
And this is where NRBQ, Nuruk, it's a funny word, Nuruk.
Breakfast with the Arts will continue with NRBQ, rock and roll's best kept secret. With NRBQ's new lineup intact, augmented by the whole wheat horns with Terry's brother Don on trombone, the band swung into high gear, recording a series of critically acclaimed albums loaded with potential hit songs.
Typical NRBQ career scenario would be kind of like, you know, a record executive would see the band, get excited, sign them to the label. The band would record a great album, and then just before it gets released, that executive would get fired or quit or arrested on a morals charge or something. And then a new guy would come in and not be interested in anything that the old guy had. And so the album would get released, but with very little promotion, and nobody would hear it.
If I didn't know better, I'd say that stupid run record companies.
But despite the urging of their various labels, NRBQ has never changed its sound to cash in on whatever was selling at the moment.
Everybody's got to know what where their place is and what they're going to do and what they're not going to do, you know?
Yeah, I think it's a lot easier to have musical integrity if you're making millions of dollars and you don't have to worry about feeding your family or paying the bills. But when a band sticks to their guns creatively, even though they're living gig to gig and not getting the attention they deserve, you know, I think that's truly to be admired.
We decided a long time ago what we're not going to do.
I'd have to say they do the same show whether there's 10 people or 10,000 people. You know, they remain consistent. They're true to themselves.
Playing the music you love and being with the right guys is too good of a thing to mess with.
The thing about a band is, can they hang? And you know that guys can get along for that amount of time. They've got something going.
In the 1980s, rock and roll and professional wrestling formed an unlikely yet highly successful connection. But the idea was actually originated 2 years earlier by NRBQ, when they hired wrestling manager Captain Lou Albano to guide their career.
We just loved Captain Lou because he managed a team of wrestlers that we really liked a lot. And we got to meet him.
He got on the bus and we were laughing and I said, hey, you want to get in the music business? And he said, yeah.
And next thing you know, we were thinking, Captain Lou is our manager. I said, what would that be like? That's crazy. I said, and so that's what we did.
You recognize this lovely melody? Well, I don't either. And furthermore, I don't care. The only thing I care about is NRBQ. Round the records. NRBQ, Tiddlywinks, baby.
He did everything we asked him to. He said, come out and insult the audience.
Ah!
They were insulted.
But, you know, like things go, it didn't... someone else saw our idea and wanted to do it and took it, and so we abandoned it. So.
Despite their lack of mainstream success, NRBQ was constantly winning new fans among rock and roll's finest.
My original introduction to them was in a strange way, making a movie. I made it when I had to do, I didn't have to, but I wanted to. Hail, Hail, Rock and Roll with Taylor Hackford. The job came up, who's going to run the band for Chuck Berry, you know? And it was like, There's no way anybody else was going to do it except me. I knew it was going to be a task because Chuck is an has his own idiosyncrasies. But bless his heart, Chuck, how you doing?
I got a call first from Steve Jordan, who's a friend of mine. He used to come and see our band a lot. Great drummer. And he told me that him and Keith Richards was putting together a band to back Chuck Berry in this movie that they were making about him. And they were trying to put together a band that that Chuck wouldn't hate.
And then Steve Jordan said, what about bass? And this is where NRBQ, Nurbuk, it's a funny word, Nurbuk. But, and Steve said, the man for it is Joey Spampinato.
He took Keith to hear NRBQ live because he wanted to hear what was going on here, you know. And so, you know, it was a wild night that we played at the Bottom Line in New York City.
I never went to college, no time to read the books. That's sweet by his education.
And after the set, he came back and asked me if I'd be interested in doing it.
He can play like a bass player, not like a bass guitar player. There's a difference, believe me. And the last thing I wanted was somebody that sounded like a bass guitar player, because all of Chuck's stuff is basically made for upright bass and a swing thing. So Joey comes in and I'm amazed. How do you do that? You know, I mean, I've been around by then.
Joey and the rest of NRBQ were becoming favorites of music business insiders, such as producer Hal Wilner, who recruited the band for an album of Disney songs performed by contemporary artists.
First time I ever heard of NRBQ, they were on a Disney CD called Stay Awake, and they did Whistle While You Work, which is like one of the best tunes on the thing.
And as you sweep the room, imagine that the broom is someone that you love, and soon you'll find me dancing to the tune.
NRBQ's next film project was slightly different than Snow White. Horror movie director George Romero cast them in Day of the Dead as flesh-eating zombies, and the band received their first Hollywood paycheck.
A dollar and a sandwich.
In 1989, NRBQ had their first major label release in 20 years, Wild Weekend. The album also contained the Terry Adams composition, Little Floater.
We actually had to give a top 10 list. So I listed Riding in My Car, I think, but I could have easily listed Me and the Boys or Little Floater.
Floater is one of the best songs ever written.
With bands like Nirvana and Soundgarden starting to populate radio playlists, however, the record label quickly gave up on pushing NRBQ's upbeat, musically diverse sound. Coming up next, NRBQ plunges into decade number 3 with its first new member in 22 years and keeps on rocking into the new millennium.
Breakfast.
Carolinas with AroundCarolina.com. It's the web destination that leads the Carolinas to you. AroundCarolina.com gives you all the time.
The 1990s started with the release of a double CD on Rhino Records, chronicling the first 20 years of NRBQ.
I think if you're completely unfamiliar with NRBQ, a great starting point is a double CD set called Peekaboo. It really gives you a good idea of what the band is all about.
This was followed by 1994's Message for the Message.
They have a tremendous knack for being able to make a great song out of a very mundane topic. They can, like Girl Scout cookies.
It was their final album with guitarist Al Anderson, who left the band after 23 years for a successful songwriting career in Nashville. To replace Anderson, NRBQ kept it all in the family and hired Johnny Spampinato, Joey's younger brother.
It was a great opportunity to play with my brother for the first time.
He started out listening to our band right from the beginning when he was 12 or something.
I mean, I remember watching them rehearse in our house, and my dad would record them, you know. And we would, like, some of my friends would come in, and we would, like, all sit around, and we have to be quiet.
It's a kick for me now. He's in the band, and, you know, it feels good on stage.
They asked me to do the Conan O'Brien show, and I did, and these guys were on the show at night. And Max and I both were looking at them and amazed at the energy that they were generating and the way that Tommy, the drummer, was playing that backbeat. Twisting his stick around, Max and I both said, "Will you look at that guy? How does he do that?"
You know, I miss the original drummers of rock and roll that would play like that, but I, somewhere in the back of my head, I knew, not being a musicologist, I could tell the difference of why they sounded like the real deal and other bands sounded like garage bands at a frat party.
In 1998, NRBQ recorded their first children's album, You're Nice People You Are.
It was one of the most fun records for me to make, and I'd like to do another one.
Spider crawling on a window pane. Spider, spider, listen to the falling.
Riding along and in the car, and Tommy started to do something on the windshield and say, "Spider, spider." And so I said, "Tommy, there's something there." Spider.
The following year saw the release of the band's 15th studio album. Just like their first record 30 years earlier, it was called simply NRBQ. Where is NRBQ in the new millennium? On the road, of course.
We'll be right back.
reason I wanted to do the show was not to be like about, oh, you know, this poor band that nobody knows. That wasn't the case at all. This is about the poor audience who doesn't know this band.
We're also back in their Vermont studio working on yet another new album.
Kind of have that gun smoke guitar sound.
Gun smoke.
They have two brothers in the band because the DNA that went into their vocal cords created something nice.
In a business where most bands don't last more than a few years, how has NRBQ stayed together over three decades?
We have a lot of respect for each other. We have a lot of the same likes as far as what amuses us and old television shows that we like, and so, you know, that, you know, keeps the thing, you know, going, I think.
I like Green Acres. I like Beaver.
About a sense of humor, I think.
Beaver's pretty much the top.
Without fame and millions to fight over, the band can spend its time arguing over what really matters. Who's the best TV judge?
Judy.
Judge Joe Brown.
How do you stay away from Judge Judy? She's gonna find her way into your life.
Get some sense in your head. Get some responsibility and get alive. Go out and get alive and do something with yourself. You're acting like a five-year-old.
Whether or not they ever become a household word, NRBQ will keep on doing what it's done the past 35 years, playing great rock and roll and singing about girls, cars, hotel maids, and food.
You got them up and any buttered it down. Popping it, he popped it up. He popped that corn right up. Johnny got some popcorn and he popped it up.
I think humor is important in rock and roll, all music. Don't take yourself too seriously, you know.
I would just recommend to anybody that if they see that NRBQ is coming through town, that they should go see a show, because it will really blow your mind. They're just amazingly good live, and it's always fun.
So why should you give NRBQ a chance?
Because you probably haven't heard them yet, and they're just going to make your life longer.
The most significant band that I could mention, and I love the Rolling Stones in a way that, you know, defies description, but I think NRBQ is the best rock and roll band in the world. Always have, and I always will.
It drives me nuts that something so good and so fun isn't known by more people.
Well, what is it, 30 years recording now, boys? You know, you're catching up.
Butter that muffin down.
Q headquarters. Look, honey, I'm doing an interview for you. And you're on right now. Do you want to say anything to the people? Yes, would you like to say anything to the audience? Okay, here you go. Go ahead.
I love you all. I love you all.
Okay, all right. Okay, I'll talk to you soon. Do we want any food before she closes?
Up next, our special guests this morning are NRBQ here in our studio. Don't go away.
Tomorrow, what's it like?
The A&E Artists of the Week, NRBQ.
We hope you enjoyed the documentary about NRBQ, but the big news is they're actually here in our studio today to perform for us. This is our production studio, and they're going to play in here in just a little bit, but right now they're in the dressing room, in the green room. Now, it may look like it's my dressing room because it's got my name on it, but actually it's the dressing room. It's the only one we have. So let's go inside, and we'll introduce you to NRBQ.
Hey.
Keep him out of here.
Keep him out of here. Terry, thank you so much for being here.
Elliot.
Right, yeah.
I've seen you.
Yeah, then this is Johnny. Thank you again for being here. Tom.
Meow.
Meow, thank you so much. We're so glad that you're here.
It's nice to be here.
That you can perform for us today. You know what you're going to sing?
Not yet.
No?
Wait for you to tell us.
I get, like, whatever, you take requests today, then?
Yeah, maybe. Whatever you want.
All right, good. Well, I got a few favorites. Where's Joey?
He's over there with the makeup guy.
Here, let's just go ahead and say hello to Joey. This is Seagal. She does her makeup. This is Joey Spampanato.
Hey.
Thanks for being... Oh, no. Oh, big coffee mess. All right, let's get him another chair. We'll come back. We'll come back. Pay no attention to these people over here. Let's just leave them, give some privacy over here, all right?
Joey got a little mess on him. We're going to fix everything up.
So what's your impression of this documentary finally coming out? I mean, do you think this will be a new turning point in the history of NRBQ, that people, a lot of other people, find out about the band, and it'll be another 30 years that you'll be around?
Well, we're very proud of you for having a part of this documentary.
Oh, well, we just showed it, that's all.
You and Mike Scully and the people that are doing it, we think you're all very nice.
Well, we enjoyed it. We got a great response the first time, and we were so pleased to show it again.
Monterey was a turning point in the history of America.
And now?
Now, here we are.
And now the airing of this documentary. Yeah, that's right. Somebody grabbed that other album that's out there. I want to see. They're going to bring it back in here.
Maybe, okay.
The whole thrust of the documentary was interesting to me, too, because it's sort of the... A lot of people have not heard of you. Do you have any personal theory as to why you can be together for so long and have so many devoted fans and still not attract, I guess, pop culture, or have a lot of people not know who you are?
It's sort of a mystery, isn't it?
It is a mystery.
Depends on who's talking, who hadn't heard, you know what I mean?
Well, obviously a lot of people have. I mean, like some of the greatest rock and roll people in the world. Are on that documentary, and obviously they love you a lot.
But the top 40 or something like that, or what gets exposed, really kind of serves its own purpose. It's sort of like it tells you what to buy. It doesn't necessarily tell you the truth. It's sort of its own self-serving thing, I think.
Well, it is about sort of radio play and who controls all that kind of stuff. That must be very disconcerting.
They haven't been told to buy us yet.
We could be the most famous popular band, but if somebody's not making money off of it, there's no reason to talk about it except for, occasionally.
Well, somebody's going to be making a little dough. I hope it's you guys for the first time in the music of the industry.
No, it's not.
This is the latest one. You had given me this earlier. Azza My Band. Is that Italian for something?
Azza My Band.
Azza My Band.
You could call it Italian.
Yes.
You might call it Italian.
Is it fake Italian or?
Azza My Band. What do they mean?
Italian,
do you like it?
American Italian.
I do like it, although I have a question for you.
The question and the answers.
Yeah, I know about the little ones where you put in the CD players, but I'm not sure what this is. How does this work? This is not going to fit into my...
They used to call those RPLP
RPLs, they were called.
Yeah.
This is actually, it's kind of like the needle goes here. It's kind of like sex in a way, because they have to touch each other to make something happen.
Isn't that exciting? And there's
with
a hole
CD,
in the
CD, nothing actually touches anything.
It's physical.
You put it on the Victrola.
It's a physical thing.
And it plays.
Here, let's talk about some of the
tunes.
Before
that, they used to have them on cylinders.
Something wire here.
You know why cylinders stopped? Nobody could play the B-sides.
Is that right?
Well, there's an A and a B side on this. Hey, I'm just going to do this at random here because I think one of my favorite songs as a kid growing up, because I used to love watching those musicals, was Wandering Star. Mm. To hear Lee Marvin sing that song, why did you decide to pick that song and cover it?
Because we love Lee Marvin.
Yeah, it's a great song, and it's always good for musicians to stay open to anything. You could find something and paint your wagon, you know, or in a classical thing, anywhere. You never know where something's going to change your life, and Wandering Star is one of those songs.
The thing about Lee Marvin is I never knew exactly what note he was on, right? Because he would just
sing so low.
He would just rum. Yeah, here. How did it go?
Really low.
Right.
He's got a high fidelity voice.
No matter how low you sing, it's lower than that.
It's still lower
than that. In other words, it's lower than that.
You know who else has a great voice? Connie Stevens.
No.
She's got one of those kind of voices that sound good on television and movies.
She's made lots of records.
Yeah.
She was a hot thing.
Kooky Kooky, Lend Me Your Calm really was her record.
That's her.
Not, well, Ed Burns is great, but, you know, Connie Stevens really had a lot to do with it.
When you're at home and you're just sort of relaxing, is that what you listen to, Connie Stevens, or classical music? What do you listen to?
I think all of us will listen to anything, and to keep it interesting, keep changing it, you know.
Same for all of you? Do you listen to a lot of different kind of things?
Yeah, you have to keep it moving, otherwise you get bored. That's our attitude when we play too. We just try to keep it moving so we don't get bored. And then maybe you won't either.
And if you can enjoy all kinds of music, it promotes peace. It promotes understanding among people.
Yeah. Now, I noticed your war button here today, your no war button. I mean, you know, one of the things you read about NRBQ is the feeling that music can really have a profound effect on people's lives. Are you still optimistic about that?
Yeah, we just tell people to vote no on the killing proposition.
You don't usually get to vote on that, unfortunately. I haven't seen that on the ballot too many times.
Yeah, that's right, you know. Just love each other, don't kill anybody. Don't kill dogs or cats either. You just keep everything, you know, nice and enjoy life. That's our philosophy.
Let's make love, not war.
Yeah.
I guess if, you know, everybody's just at the concert listening to you play, they can't get into trouble and start anything. So I guess, ultimately, if you just play long enough,
we're keeping people out of trouble.
It's up to you. The first song on the album is The first song is Norma. Is that a real person?
Norma actually is a song called Norman.
It's my dad's name.
Norman, yeah. And I loved the song for a long time. I guess all of us did. But I couldn't figure out how to do it because I didn't want to sing about a guy. And then it hit me that if I took the N off, I could do the song. You know, I mean, you knew that was coming. But
dropped the N.
I didn't really ask John D. Loudermilk, the composer, whether it was okay to take the N off or not. And I hope that
wherever the estate
and wherever he is now doesn't mind. This money is just the same, but the song title is now changed. Norma.
I wanted to ask you about the floor. You volunteered to be here, and you said you like.
I belong on the floor.
Yeah, can you explain that to me?
I just feel comfortable on the floor. Nearer to the record player and nearer to everything.
When we met him, he was on the floor.
I'm always on the floor.
Tell me the moment he was on the floor and you met him.
See the position he's in right now?
Yeah.
He was like that since he was 2, playing records in his basement, in that position right there.
I used to be on the floor in front of the heater in the winter. I love the heater. I love heat.
You can't fall as far either.
No.
The closer to the floor you are.
If I'm nearer to the cat, you know.
If he could play the bass drum and the hi-hat on the floor,
I would do it.
You would do that?
You wouldn't have to sit on that stool.
Yeah. The throne. The drummer's throne, they call it.
You play an instrument, don't you, Elliot?
I play bass.
He's a bassist.
I play bass guitar.
I know.
Let's test him out today.
All right.
Yeah, in case Joey gets some wild ideas to go on a road with the Stones or something.
All right,
you might be getting a call.
All right, I have to work up a couple of licks. I read really well, so if you have charts, do you have the NRBQ charts?
We can get charts.
If you have it written down, I can read and play.
And that's good. That's a good sign.
Wow. Not great by ear, but I can play if I can read. I wanted to ask you about the Wild Weekend, the second annual Wild Weekend. What is that?
It's on our date. It's on our list.
Every weekend we play. It's a wild weekend.
It's a wild weekend. just another show, another concert? Do you get tired of the road? I mean, you guys travel all the time.
Well, you know, there's times when you're out there for a while you'd like to go home, but I don't know. We're so used to playing, it feels weird if you're not playing. Most of the time.
Is that when you feel like that's what it's all about and most alive, and when you're feeling like this is what I was meant to do is when you're
neither rain nor sleep nor snow or gloom of the night can stop these swift couriers from delivering what is, I don't know what it, I lost it, sorry.
Playing music.
Yeah, that's it.
From their appointed rounds.
Appointed rounds.
He knows it.
And this is one of our appointed rounds today, right here on A&E. My favorite network.
I mean, obviously, you write songs, you do originals, people want that, but you'll cover things, as we've talked about, and is that a communal thing where somebody will bring it in and go, hey, this would be good, let's try this, or how do you decide when you're going to cover something like that?
Anything goes.
Make Johnny talk.
Right, Johnny?
We sort of talk it over. We talk it over.
Then we have a vote.
And if we get like some excitement out of the whole conversation, then we know it's going to happen. If nobody just sort of says anything or just sort of lays there and
you know, somebody
just
brings
move
up,
on.
If somebody has a brain, you know, a brain
someone has
light
a brain,
bulb.
Period.
Brain period is good.
Yeah.
And have you ever played something, you know, voted on it? You
sure,
did
I get plenty of them. I bring them up and everybody goes, okay, we'll do it sometime. we'll do that sometime.
You know right away. It's out.
But with this album, what the fun we had was that we did songs we don't even like. Which is a whole new concept for bands to come in and just do songs you maybe hate, but you get something out of it, you know?
Hey, that's my cell phone. Can you pardon me for one minute?
Oh,
go on without me making a call.
Interesting.
You
want to
know who
there.
It is.
Here, we got the notes. Ah, so you guys, when you played at the... You may not have heard
got a
of this,
pencil. Let's
but,
cross this stuff out.
Okay. You know, and downloading radio play is...
Oh, he's reading my notes.
Oh, hi. I didn't create...
You weren't reading my notes.
Pick that up.
We're a mess here today.
Hello.
Sorry about that.
Hello over here. Hello over here.
Yeah, I was going to tell you, I've downloaded some of your songs.
Reese's.
Yeah, some
I've
of my
got my own notes.
Reese's. Look at that.
I've got
you
my
got
own notes.
Notes today.
And I've got my own photographs to admire.
Elliot, we're ready for the band.
What? You guys ready to play?
We gotta play now.
Let's do it.
It's time to play.
Hit the studio. Let's do it.
Oh, that was good.
Yeah.
Oh, I can. Jimmy, you're okay.
Oh, yeah.
Hi, Mom. Hi, kids.
We'll be back in a moment with NRBQ.
Don't leave out the beat.
You set? Ladies and gentlemen, NRBQ.
Yeah. were drawn out here. It was like you really wanted to play. You wanted to see what it was like, right?
I wanted to see what kind of piano A&E had.
So how do we stack up? You know, it's a Steinway.
It's very nice. Very nice.
In the documentary we saw, they said that you play electric bass like some people play stand-up bass. How do you do that?
Well, when I first started playing, you know, it's like all the cool music was done with upright bass. And all the rhythm and blues, it's all, you know, that all was the sound, you know. Now the sound of bass has turned into this, like, gravelly, whiny thing. I don't like it.
Thank you.
So you want to talk to a drummer?
Is there a downside in talking to a drummer? A
musician's best friend is the drummer, they say.
I got a party in my head.
What are you gonna play? What's the last song you're gonna hit for?
Joey, you wanna sing Go See the Good? Okay. Why don't you just start in on there, okay?
Well, I'm about to do a pimp and a hip start to say. Natural love, guess you blame you for trying. Woo.
show. Oh, but ain't a matter of fact, would you say she's on my better, yo? I'll tear her, knock it out.
All righty. Tom, thank you so much for being here. Terry, terrific. Thank you. Johnny and Joey, thank you so much for being here. NRBQ, one more time.
For more information on NRBQ, including tour dates, vinyl, and CDs, go to the band's website at nrbq.com.
Coming up next, the cast of Matchstick Men.